Last night's movie was a great introduction into the purpose of relationship. And I might make a note here today that A Course in Miracles is a very practical tool. At one point, Jesus says, don't be afraid, you're not going to be hurled into reality. That's good. None of us will be hurled into reality. And I have, over the years of working with the Course for 30 years, I have had people that come to me and they go, oh, I've done this special relationship stuff. I'm never getting into another special relationship ever again in my life. What they don't understand is like a fish saying, you know, I'm not going to be in water ever again. Making a pronouncement. No, the whole cosmos is projection of specialness. So it's really, that's what the matrix is. It's just specialness projected. And so basically, Jesus, the Holy Spirit, your intuition is very practical. It's not planning to throw you into eternity from time and space. You're going to have to do, just like in this world, you have to develop skills. As we work with the Spirit, we have to keep getting our skills and abilities and attractions and preferences and judgments over to the Holy Spirit, saying, surely you can make better use of this than I did. And the Spirit's like, oh yeah, I can brighten your world up, but you have to give me everything that the ego made. So the Holy Spirit can use what the ego made. For what? For reinterpretation. That's what all this is about. We're asking for a reinterpretation of the world. We're saying here, it was full of guilt and shame and pain. We give it back now. We didn't do a very good job. You know, it's been very dark. We give it back to you to lighten. So if you work with the Course in Miracles, the Holy Spirit will use your special relationships, meaning everything about your life and form, including the body, will use the special relationships to point back towards holiness. You aren't going to be leapfrogging over specialness. Just like the fish is not going to just come leaping out of the water and then go take off flying in the air. The fish has got a journey in water. And it's going to be in water. We have seen it when fishes get washed up on the shore, and they're just, whether it's dolphins or whales or different types of fish, they don't do well on the sand. They had to have some help. Humans had to move them back into the water. And we are going to be working in the context of the water. We're going to be working in the context of specialness. Even with all the skills and abilities that you have as a human being, those were all developed in an ego context. The Spirit's perfect. It doesn't need skills and abilities. For what? It's already perfect. So these skills and abilities have been developed in an ego framework, and then the Spirit will use them to extend the experience of love and light and joy and life. So it's going to be going from a sense of fear and guilt and shame and pain into the Spirit's use of special relationships. And that he even calls your special function. You will be given a special function with the skills and abilities that you seem to have developed in an earth group. So, last night's movie was a great example of the progression of content over form, where it was a progression in relationship to a deepening, to a deeper experience of connection at the end of the movie. There was a very strong feeling of connection at the end of the movie. Tonight's movie will actually show you a progression of communication towards higher and higher levels of communication. Now that's really what this experience on planet Earth is about, is giving yourself permission to go into higher and higher levels of communication. You could call them frequencies, you could call them levels of awareness, you could call it anything you want, but the purpose is to go higher and higher. Now we have a lot of religions that are dualistic religions, and they say this is morally right, and this is morally wrong, and you should be in this box, and never go in that box, and do these things, and don't do these things, and here's the rules, and this, we get back to heaven. But it's going to be very slow if you try to do it through these boxes. Because it's all about raising the frequency, raising the level of communication to deeper, deeper, higher and higher levels of communication. Today, in the world of technology, we have a lot of young people around the world who are by their computers and their iPads and their little iPhones, and they're doing gaming. Don't you know, kids love gaming. And what is it they love about gaming is there's a challenge to it. They like ever-increasing complications of gaming so that they can go from level 1 to level 2 to level 3 to level 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. The kids love it. It's gonna change the way people seem to learn. People don't want to go sit in classrooms and have somebody out there talking to them and take a test. It's not it. The old way of education is going bye-bye. Because the children want something that's entertaining, that's challenging, and that they can progress in. A lot of times children like to progress in their gaming exploits more so than material rewards. You can offer them money, you can offer them all kinds of things. They got a challenge. And you might say, spiritually too, it's about raising your level of awareness, working with the spirit to raise your level of awareness. And that's what it's about. Now, we have many phenomena in this modern times. Like in the old days, we had movies, and people would go out on a date. Now we have things like speed dating, where you go and you get to meet 10, 15 people. See how this will help speed things up. So spending 15 years going, what was I thinking, really, you know. They actually go through speed dating, and it makes it speed the whole thing up a lot faster. Maybe we will develop apps for our phones and iPads that will help us with this raising our level of communication. In other words, we know that if you want to get better at a sport, you're supposed to play up. You play somebody as good or better than you if you want to improve your skills in a rapid way. Well, maybe that's what we should be doing with our relationships, playing up. If you play down, you just end up with a bunch of regrets. Like, what did I waste 15 years doing here? And the other thing is about this longevity. You know, we've got things here about, how long we've been married. We have a silver anniversary, and a gold anniversary, and a diamond anniversary. And this is, you know, you shouldn't get awards for how long you keep the bodies under the same roof. What's the level of the vibrational communication going on here? You think you get, okay, been married 75 years, I get a diamond. You get the Holy Spirit, it's like, you wasted 75 years. I was trying to get a hold of you so we could improve some depth and improve your level of communication, and you've been stuck in the same house versus the same person for 75 years. You know, you don't get some kind of reward for that. You simply punish yourself for 75 years because, the world goes, wow, 75 years, that's an amazing accomplishment. Jesus says, no, minds are joined. Bodies do not. That's from Jesus. Minds are joined, bodies do not. No bonus points for bodies together. That was a different generation. The younger generation ain't going for it. So this movie is good because this movie we're watching tonight will make use of technology. Last night we got to follow the main character. Time was already, he, she, it was all a around in all kinds of forms already, and then you have to watch the relationship progress. Tonight, we're going to have the main character, played by Joaquin Phoenix. He's going through a divorce. He's separated from his wife. So he's going through emotional issues that come during a divorce and separation. So he's got his job, but he's going through a lot of emotional issues. And how will the Holy Spirit help him? He will help him with an operating system. Just like if you have a computer or an iPhone, a smartphone, the device has an operating system. Well, this is going to be one great operating system. Scarlett Johansson, the voice of Scarlett Johansson, is going to be his operating system. And she's going to bring him back to life. You know, she's going to help him work through those emotional things that he's stuck on. And she's going to help him open up his heart. And then the movie will go on much beyond that, just like last night's movie just kept going and going and going and going. Because this movie is about raising the level of communication. On this planet, when we think of people like Einstein, you know, Einstein seemed to be, with his level of thinking, he seemed to be on a level that was way above the norms. I mean, Einstein would drop out of school because he was too bored with school. His mind was so far ahead of what they were teaching in school. He was going to the further reaches of learning. And we can say that with a lot of things in spirituality. You know, you don't want a religion that will just placate you with theology or try to prop you up, or try to just make you comfortable. You want a spirituality that will stretch your mind, that will help you grow and expand in consciousness and awareness. You want interactions with people that are helping you grow and expand in awareness, taking you back towards that oneness of pure spirit. And so, this is really good in this movie. We will see that evolution throughout the movie. And to me, this is a great reflection of what we're all calling for. We're all calling for that expanded state of awareness. We know it's not a theology. It's not something we can just read out of a book and memorize. We have to open ourselves, be stretched, be expanded into higher and higher states of awareness. It also brings in, this movie brings in Alan Watts. Is anyone familiar with Alan Watts?
Yeah.
Oh, it's so sweet that he's incorporated into this movie. Because Alan Watts in this movie represents a higher order of thinking. Some of us who've been graced by hearing some of his talks, you feel that presence come through. The presence will come through in this movie, but it comes in, it's woven into the storyline in a very unexpected way. And our main character will have to face a lot of things that came up, jealousy, other things we talked about. Alan Watts is a spiritual teacher. And he comes more from the, I would say more like the Eastern perspective, but very engaging, brilliant spiritual teacher. So, when you're watching this movie and Alan Watts gets introduced into the plot line, you'll have an idea like what's coming.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? When he starts to get introduced. So. Okay, I think that's good. I think we'll show the movie, and I may pause it a few times, but we'll really have a... I think you'll find this...
I get it, Rodrigo.
So the point is here... And please give us the metaphysical interpretation, please. We need it quickly. He's going through a divorce. He's lonely. He's trying to distract himself. He can't sleep in the middle of the night. Some of you can't sleep too, but you're up for good reasons, because the spirit's really stirring things up. He's very lonely. And so this is good to take note. This is his level of communication.
here.
When you're lonely, you're down, your vibration is down pretty low. And you'll do desperate things, right? We've been there. So this is good because he needs help and he's going to be looking for something to help bring him up, as all of us have done when we get to those times dark. So you see, it's going to get good now. You're going to feel wrong in this, or you're going to have your mind broken. But basically, first she was joining the book club, remember, because she wanted to study physics because of that remark, like she was thinking, I don't have a body. So she was feeling like she was missing something, not having a body. So she's studying physics to expand her horizons and consciousness. And now this is very much like trying to have a threesome. So this is expanded. You can see this is expanding beyond it's going from exclusion to inclusion, but it's pushing him beyond his comfort zone. And this happens, of course, in relationships on planet Earth. So it's going to start to progress pretty quickly now, as this is the point of the movie where we're going to start to see the consciousness raising up higher and expanding, having to, because it has to be able to encompass what's occurring. And it's really, the world is just reflecting what's occurring. So this is what I was starting to talk about at the beginning. This whole realm is a realm of specialness. So even though he and his operating system really were getting on and having a very flowing communication, you know, this is the realm where there are bodies. We're dealing with bodies. We're dealing with body thoughts. So this is going to be a complete resurrection of the mind to come back to spirit, because as long as you're dealing with body thoughts, I'll call them, you're going to be dealing with guilt. You're going to be dealing with guilt in the realm of the body thoughts. But remember, it's the Holy Spirit's task to purify the mind, not to take from you what was made. It's like it's going to have to be a reinterpretation of everything that the ego made, including the body. So this is not something that you can just try to skip over things with. There's going to be, you might say, a lot of guilt that will come up. And what seems to be relationships in this world, he just has gone through that relationship with his wife, having thoughts of her, and divorcing her, and there's a lot of sadness still there, a lot of issues coming up, and now his operating systems, the man that he's really, it's a real sense of hurt, feeling like an aliveness with the world, and it seems helpful for him, but as soon as the surrogate seems to come in, it just jolted him again, because he's got this communication flow going, and yet it's with an operating system who doesn't have a body, and then as soon as the circuit comes in, then there's an awkwardness because he has judgments about that. And those are the same judgments in the mind where we believe that there is such a thing as a physical realm that's apart from our consciousness. When we believe matter is solid and mind is not, and that our thoughts are different from the world, we still have a split going on between like a subject and an object, a perceiver and a perceived, an observer and an observed. That's the split of consciousness between the observer and the observed. It's all unified. It's really all one experience. But as long as that split is in consciousness, there's going to be guilt. Because there is no split in reality. God didn't create a split. It's just all pure oneness, and it's all unified awareness in terms of forgiveness. So at this point, you could say it's been like a step of him starting to recover from his sadness around his wife and starting to open up and everything. But this experience, you know, the old line, "Choose company, freeze a crowd," it gives new meaning to that with the surrogate sex partner for an operating system. But still, You know, this is just another version of that inclusion-exclusion thing. Like, he's perceiving, he was a bit shocked when she wanted to do this experiment, so to speak, because he was like inviting someone else in. And remember, their first kind of sexual experience was feeling like the whole world just disappeared and it was just us two. And we've all gone through those experiences of feeling, wow, it's just us. And the whole world's gone, and only us. But there's more than that, because of us still involve bodies, and it still involves guilt, and it really isn't the vastness of who we are. So now it's going to start picking up, because this has been like the first major issue that has come into his relationship with his operating system. But she's already expanding, growing, reading, exploring physics, and beginning to open up. And that's the best part of all this, is that vibrationally you start to see reflections of where your consciousness is, and it will start expanding. And that's always for the good, even though emotionally it can be challenging to the ego, that expanding your awareness is always helpful. It's always a movement in the right direction. Upgrading allows us to move past matter as our processing platform. So really nothing's gone wrong, she's just advancing rapidly. And he just, that was the fear of loss coming up. Big time.
Oh, yeah.
You can talk to anyone else while we're talking. Yeah. We think it has to be so, but it's simultaneous. It could be simultaneous. Mm-hmm. So now he's like, this is where the exclusion gets threatened. And, you know, when higher communications and the idea of talking, are you talking to anyone else while we're talking? Yes. He's trying to figure out how to say it too. Now this is what I'm talking about. This is where it's going. So it's good that you have a movie like this that you prepared. That's our second night movie. Cool. Blowing some air. Whether you have a body or not, it's beautiful. Yeah, it's supposed to open the possibilities when you think about your life and how you use your life, you know, to expand your communication, deepen your communication. Have that be a priority over the things that seem to be so important in this world. I think that movie helps us put things into a perspective. You're saying, just hearing her voice, now you're interested in Lucy.
Yeah, yeah. I saw a few reviews.
Yeah,
I didn't see the movie, but now I've heard the voice myself.
Says, what's your appetite for more? And that's partly what we have this Delta site moviegoers, movie watchers guide to enlightenment, is to help, you know, through these experiences of watching movies, to start to open up to possibilities of how you can use your life, your time, in order to expand. Because you can see that there's a threat there in terms of exclusivity. It kind of came pretty much towards the end of the movie, but it was, you know, how many people are you talking to now? You know, and she said she was having simultaneous conversations, and then are you in love with anyone else? And then how many? You know, it just kind of kept. And just the look on his face, you know, it's really for all of us, because we have to let go of our preconceptions. We're being taken higher and higher and higher If that's our journey, that's what it's all about. Our journey really isn't about clinging to the past, or clinging with the familiar, or even clinging to our self-image. Because everyone who seems to come to this world wears a mask. And so we don't have to deny that, but we can say maybe, just maybe, the Holy Spirit will start exchanging some masks in a way that we won't be hurled back into eternity. We won't be hurled beyond time and space, but we will be given opportunities to loosen from the masks that we've been wearing and perhaps put on some more expansive masks. And there's still masks, but that's how we wake up. You know, we have to go through expansion. And I think this movie is good because it, you know, start to see, wow, okay, I can see in the context of this movie that I just need to be open and welcome some of the things that the Spirit is calling me to. As we shared before, it says in A Course in Miracles, there are many answers you have received but have not heard. We've just been afraid to hear the answers that are already in our own hearts. The answers are already there, but we have to be ready to hear them. We have to be ready for new ideas. There was a part in the movie where, toward the end, he just said, she said, there's something I have to talk to you about. He said, I don't want to hear it. You know, that's the human condition. I don't want to hear. It could be, as I travel around the world and meet all these Course in Miracles students now in all these countries, you know, that could be a thing like, how can I hear the voice of the Holy Spirit? Because they sense from being a Course student that that would be extremely valuable to be instructed by the Holy Spirit, to be guided by the Holy Spirit, but the thing that's underneath that is real honesty around the question, do I want to hear? If there's a threat to the world that's been constructed, or a threat to the identity that's been constructed and is being held onto, then the answer to that question would be no. It would be like, stop. Go away. And I have experienced in my life that as I was very eager and willing, that because of my willingness, the lessons just came so fast. They came rapidly, one after the next after the next. In the early years, a lot of times I would start to feel a nudge to take a certain step or a certain leap, and it seemed like a giant leap to me. And yet, when I really got my willingness to take the leap that I was being asked to take, I landed pretty nicely. I was, ooh, yeah, that wasn't so bad. And then another leap. That wasn't so bad either. You know, you see, that's where the trust start to build. Some things that were nudged and prompted to do or say, some steps we would take, that the ego would say, no way, that's too risky. No, don't even consider it. Don't even go there. And the Spirit's like telling us, you know, this will build your confidence. You take this step, it may seem risky to the ego, but it's not really risky at all. It will build your trust and your confidence. And so, slowly in my life, it felt like I was again taking more leaps and landing. And another leap. Okay. You know, you start the things that you could not have even imagined doing or following suddenly becomes pretty easy. You know, like, wow, that it would have scared me in the past, but that leap doesn't scare me anymore. And that's how the Spirit wants us to go, in that direction, building that trust. There's one point in the Course in Miracles where Jesus says, the Holy Spirit needs happy learners. Isn't that an interesting idea? The Holy Spirit needs happy learners. In other words, the more confidence I gained from my leaps, the more I thought, wow, this is great. This is bringing me everything I ever wanted. And then the more confidence I had in that, the happier I became. And then the happier I became, the more the Holy Spirit's like, now we're talking. Now we can really get going towards this forgiveness thing. When we're limited and when we're fearful, it seems like such a difficult task to forgive. These grievances seem like stone walls. You know, we have these etched grievances where it's like a stone wall. We have a little hammer and we're just chipping away at the stone, wondering how is this grievance ever going to go? It's so deep, it's so deeply built. It seems to have been built over so long. How is that going to go? And yet, when we really start to get into the happiness of taking the steps with the Holy Spirit, feeling that confidence, building that trust, it grows stronger and stronger. It starts to be like a momentum that builds, and the momentum grows stronger and stronger, and we start to smile. We're like, wow, the ego doesn't have a chance here. The ego is on, its days are numbered. Because we see the might and the glory of the Holy Spirit joined with our willingness. There's all these places in the Course where it says, your little willingness, there's many, many references to little willingness. But then you get back to the manual for teachers, it's something like, it takes great willingness to see that every event, encounter, and circumstance is for your own good. You know, that's where the great part comes in, when you start to realize it's all working for the good, and always has been. Every single thing, even down to the minute detail in your perceived life in this world, has been working together for the good. But with the dark filter of the ego, we were judging against it. Oh, this hadn't happened. Oh, I blew that. And, you know, we start to build up all these woulda, coulda, shouldas, all these grievances, how we could have done it differently. If I just hadn't blown it, if I could just have that moment back again, choose again. You know, we're still harping on what went wrong, and we don't really have a clue that it's all been working together for us, that we just misperceived that there was something against us. That's a very interesting line from the Bible. I was never a Bible scholar, and really got a little, some inspiration here and there, but it's, one of the lines was, if God is with us, who can be against us? And if you don't even like the word God, just think, if love is with us, what can be against us? If joy is with us, what can be against us? You see, if we flip the switch and we start to build the confidence in that small, still voice, that intuitive inner guide that we have, and we start to gain confidence, then we turn the corner. And then we start to feel, oh, the ego's days are numbered. That after a millennium of walking in the darkness, with our heads down, walking along in a very depressed, dark feeling, that suddenly there's hope, there's a ray of light. You know, if you look at Plato's cave analogy, if you go back to the ancient Greeks, which predate Jesus, Plato put down a very famous cave analogy where there's a cave, and it's very dark, and there's all these prisoners that are chained in the cave. And then there's this blazing light that's outside of the cave, like a big fire, and there are puppeteers with marionettes, and they're doing their puppeteer moves out there in front of the light, and the shadows from the fire and the puppeteers are being cast in onto a cave wall. And the prisoners are all chained there, and all they can see is the cave wall. So all they know are shadows. And that's what these things are. Everything we perceive in the world are just shadows coming from the mind, projected from the light of the mind and through the shadow and dark thoughts of the ego. So the prisoners, All they know of life is what is on that cave wall. They know nothing else. And so in the famous cave allegory, one of the prisoners finally escapes from the cave, gets out of the shackles, goes out and sees the fire, and sees the light, and is so excited about the fire, sees the whole puppet show and everything for what it is, that he's so excited he comes back in to tell the prisoners about the cave wall, what's going on, and they kill him. Because all they believe is about those shadows on the wall, so he seems like he's crazy speaking about the light and all this stuff. And it's interesting, with throughout the years of human history, the prophets, the avatars, the saints, many have been killed for talking about love and light, because it's a dark world of shadows. But it's the time that has come now, as I was saying, you know, as Pierre was saying, to have a spectacular miracles, you know, that's really what our calling is. We have been called to the light. We have been called to be the bringers of the light, to represent the light, to be the messengers of the light. Not in our words alone, but in our attitude. It's our attitude that has to be there, because if we don't have that attitude, then our words will fall on deaf ears. People will, like little children when their parents help them, they watch very closely to see if the parents emulate the words that are spoken. And if they do, there's great trust. They grow up very loving and trusting. If there's hypocrisy, they will turn. They'll be gone as a teenager or earlier. They will not hang around for a parent who's not emulating their words. So, yeah, this movie tonight gives us a real good glimpse of that higher awareness that we're capable of. And therefore, that's how we should use our discussions. I mean, we know how it can go in this world. We saw in this movie when he was distracted and depressed, how he just kind of wasted his time looking for some scraps of something to distract him away from the emptiness that he felt in his heart. That's really a waste of time. When we give into the depression, we give into the darkness, when we give into the guilt, then we're just biding our time, you know, we're just going through the motions. And it's really, we could say it's not really time as well spent as it could be. But when we're having these elevated discussions and we're looking into the deeper meanings of what it is we believe, what thoughts are we teaching and learning, what thoughts are we reinforcing in our mind, then that's a great use of time. You know, a lot of times people in this world will just specialize, they work their job. It's like the Simon Garfunkel song, Slip Sliding Away. You know? Slip sliding away, slip sliding away. You know, the nearer your destination, the more you slip sliding away. Oftentimes going to jobs to bring home a paycheck, to support a house, a roof over your head, or cars and things and stuff. And then all types of entertainment and distraction and doing all this work for what Jesus says, for things that you really don't even want. Doing meaningless things to buy things that you don't even really want or need, and then going back and doing it again. You know, he's describing it in the Course. Because it's a sad situation when you give yourself over to it, and then when you look around and you think, well, everyone else is doing it, I might as well. You've bought the bait. You've fallen into the mesmerism of sleep of this world. You know, we call it daily life, but it's like it's just another dark dream. Nightmares and then more oppressive dark dreams. And then at some point we have to think, well, wait a minute, this isn't the way that I want to use my time, my energy, my focus. I'm worth so much more than just that. I'm worth so much more. I'm worth everything, really. That's what the Spirit is telling us. You are worth everything, because you were created as everything in spirit. And now it's important to come back to that. So what I say a lot of times when I travel around and talk with groups, and we have these retreats, like, there is no accident that we have been brought together. I feel like with everyone I meet, that we are like lifelong companions on a very deep and profound journey. That we have come together with a very important purpose. And we have been brought together into each other's lives to bless, to nurture, to allow the light to raise our awareness higher and higher and higher. And that's the purpose of these movies. When we have these movie retreats, that can be very helpful. This is our second night together. You can imagine if you spend 6 weeks with me. We watch a movie like this every night. Then you actually can start to feel like you might have some shifts in consciousness, you know, because it's more of a communal feeling. We're eating together, we're taking walks together, we're meditating together, we're watching movies together and pausing them, we're laughing together. You know, the laughter gets stronger and stronger. Even movies that would be considered comedies, we're laughing at movies that would maybe even be considered serious.
Is that possible? I want to travel with you for 6 weeks.
6 weeks. Yeah. I see a hand up there. There we go. We're talking about that because actually, you know, that's what I've done over the years, is just come over and go down to Spain and rent a giant villa or a couple villas, and that's what we call a devotional retreat, where I think the first time I did it was 4 weeks, and then there's been other times with 6 weeks. But what comes at the end of those 6 weeks is that your perception of everything starts to shift, and then you start to build that confidence, like your heart starts to light up, like, ooh, okay, I can feel the potential now, I can feel what this is all about. Practically speaking, if you look at just, if we pulled all of our skills and abilities that we have just in this room, you know, the synergy that comes when you come together to join on a project or join together on an idea, we've experienced that, glimmers of it, but how powerful that is. We were here in Holland about a little over a year ago or something, and Chris was at that one, and it was just like, it just lit up, like, we've got to do something, we've got to pull it together. So we had emails kind of looking back and forth, it's hard with schedules. we said, we're kind of feeling maybe this, and Chris was suggesting some venues, and so the ideas just started floating around, and then at some point it starts to click in, like, oh, yeah, that's good, we can do that. And then it just keeps, and it's like, oh, okay, that's good. I could come, okay. And Mary, I like to come, okay. You know, it just kind of snowballs, it builds. There's a momentum that comes with it. And that's how your whole life is going to be. That's where the guidance of the Holy Spirit is going to take you, into these collaborative things. You know, there's a saying, I guess it's from the East, you know, many hands make for light work. And when we join our minds together in a real collaborative way like this, then it sends us soaring in the right direction. We don't even have to know the specifics of how it's going to go or how it's all going to work out, but we can tell from the lightness in our hearts how it feels. We like the joy. We like the intimacy. We like the love. We like the connection. And it's very much that sends you in a direction like, wow, what are the possibilities? We start to open our mind to the possibilities of what can come. So I think it's delicious. We're having a delicious experience together. It's taking us more to look at the world through quantum ways. It's like to appreciate, wow, even in this room, what a collection of thoughts that I have pulled together here. Isn't that nice, you know? Thank you, mind, for that nice collection.
Can I have
this
on?
Sure.
You want a mic?
Yeah.
The Course is no compromising, and the world is false. And when I told somebody about the real world, they always say, yes, you live in this world. And as long as you live in this world, you're not enlightened. You need herbs and to eat very health and to do all that stuff to make you happy and healthy. But is that not a false illusion that I support when I believe something else? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think it's, once you just keep reminding yourself that it's all a state of mind. The kingdom of heaven is not a place, it's a state. It's attitude, it's a state of mind, and as you become happier and happier, you don't really look back to the world, you don't have any reason to analyze the world, to figure out the world, and also there's no one else to convince. The one that needed convincing is one's own mind, and as that starts to become clear, like, oh, I see now, I'm not buying into those thoughts and ideas and beliefs anymore. Let them float by me, but I'm not taking the bite, I'm not hopping on that train anymore. Then, as Jesus said, he says in the workbook, your forehead is serene. He says, you smile more frequently. You know, he starts to give you symbols, still symbols of the body, a serene forehead, a smile on your face. He says, your eyes have not opened yet, but a smile has come across your sleeping face. You know, like when you're having, not a nightmare, but a good dream. You're in bed, your eyelid, you're in REM sleep, but you just have a big smile on your face. That's a beautiful metaphor. That
choked me with the cat.
That got the biggest laugh of the night. Joking with the dead. Yeah. And how do our dreams get so peaceful and serene and happy except we don't judge them? When we don't take them seriously and we don't judge the dreams, then they are quite peaceful and happy. It's when we're judging them and we're very critical that they quickly turn into nightmares. As if it's like out of our control and we feel powerless and helpless and at the mercy of the dream, instead of being the dreamer of the dream. So it's been fun for me because, you know, I've been just traveling around and since 1991, but in giving these same talks, I talk about the same stuff, pretty much the same stuff as I talked about in 1991. If you listen to the old recordings back in the days of cassettes, he's talking about the same stuff. He hasn't changed a bit. And there's different examples. And back then, you know, I would talk about cassette tapes and phone booths and all kinds of things that were kind of gone. But the invitations were still there, and even, you know, being able to listen to Helena and Jenny Francis, you know, they simply took me up on my invitations. Helena and Jenny from here very close in Europe, in Sweden, and then Francis from down in Australia, but that's how it's gone. I think, but people say, who do you live with? Who your relationship with? I think we have kind of a community that's kind of sprinkled now across the globe. And just this year, I've been to our community down in Australia, and I've been to a community over in Mexico, and I've been to a couple, two, three different places in the United States, and now over here. And so, yeah, it's very interesting. It doesn't so much matter what the symbols are, but it's when you start to give yourself over to spirit in that collaborative way, you start to feel the energy, the synergy start to happen. Like, oh, I'm connected. I'm working in conjunction with spirit, and things start to get lighter, much, much lighter. And any step you take with that kind of lighthearted joy in your heart, it just helps you become lighter and lighter, still lighter. So it's been for me a journey too of, I actually felt that the more I experienced it, the more I wanted to share it. Because that's the way love is. The more you experience love, then the more you want to give it away. That's what it is. It's dynamic. It's not static. So you want to share it. And you've loved those examples throughout history where there's been the sharing. So I like to put a lot of stuff. We record these sessions that we're doing here for the whole world. We put those out. We keep extending and extending so people can tune in and listen. They're doing the dishes listening to us, or they're doing the things that they need to do, but the voice is running in the background. Our voices, as we're waking up, are being used as a backdrop for people where they do write to me. They say, oh, I can't wait till the next episode. They're like a TV episode. This is like the episode, the next episode, and then and the next one, and the next one. And it's very inspirational. You know, they tell me they laugh, and they pause, they go back, they can pause it. Let me play that again. I don't think I heard that right, but I think, and then they, you know, they listen to it. So that's the invitation, yeah. It's like we are in this together, and it can be very spontaneous. With Chris organizing this, you know, Chris is practical. He's like, well, we definitely have to have a venue and a date, at least give me a venue and a date. And it took a while before that kind of came in, but then, yeah, this is how it works, you know, and yeah. People can take their practical steps. For some of us, it maybe was planned for some weeks, and others, it's more of a spontaneous thing coming at the last moment or whatever, but it's usually coming with like a calling, like, oh, I need to be there, or I need to go there. That's the Holy Spirit pumping inside, always for our good, always for our joy, our expansion. Yeah, you need to be there. Sometimes we don't even know why. Just, oh, we need to go there. Then we go and, feels good. Kenneth has been doing some traveling. You came all the way across to Utah.
Yeah.
And I hear there's some talk of Mexico.
Yeah, last night.
Yeah.
Monday.
You're going to Mexico on Monday. Okay. So there's an example. It's Kenneth. He's just going, but just to link and connect in, and there is a retreat coming up down in Spain.
Mm-hmm. Yes, there is a retreat. And in a month from now, it's on the 22nd to the 25th of September. A little 4-day retreat in our new community house outside Barcelona.
4 days?
Yeah, 3.5 days or 4 days, yeah. Just let me know if you're interested. And there will be like community experience there, so we will open doors for
days, 2 to 4 weeks. Yeah. In a very little group, we will have room for about 10 people together. And it's very nice. It's up in the mountains, beautiful nature, and really quiet and really beautiful. Like, the views are amazing. So everything is like very supportive for the minds. It's very still and very just vast and really cool place.
Yeah, as far as, and even like this kind of thing, we had a retreat over there. All of us that are here, we were over in Finland for 7 days. And we just had a great time, there was a lot of laughter, we showed movies, it was more opening the heart, and then at the end they were singing like ancient Finnish songs to us. They were being serenaded by Finnish songs, and it was very wonderful. And then at the end, just sitting around the table, okay, let's set this up for next year. They were really trying to pin me down, like, I don't know where you'll be, but next year, the year, this and this. And I said, oh, well, we'll take it to prayer and everything, but that's just, you know, it's just the way things go. It's possible when you join together to just be open to the Spirit and say, okay, what? We love to hear ideas. We love to hear your ideas. And then a lot of times when we start to share ideas, certain ideas, people go, yeah, that's a good idea. You know, and then people start to join. And Jesus talks about that in the Course. That's how you strengthen ideas in your mind, by giving them away. Mm-hmm. The more we believe them, the stronger they become, in that kind of metaphor. So that's good too, just to be able to open up with ideas, share the ideas, and go forward. And then it just grows stronger in awareness by being extended and given away. So we've just done 2 days out of our 5, and we've got lots to come. And thank you again for hosting us here, inviting us. Yeah, it's been a pleasure.
Something practical. Thank you. Thank you.